I was a little afraid, to be honest.
Because nobody tells the real stories.
That's why I was really skeptical, because I didn't understand why such a good chef would want to come to a city that was so, you know, empty. There was nothing really for him to work with, and clearly I was wrong.
In my opinion, people should take advantage of this building.
I didn't really know what to expect. I mean, I knew the chef was Danish, so I knew that there was going to be a very high level of cuisine.
When you came here and you say this restaurant could be in Copenhagen or London or Seattle, LA or whatever, but it's here in La Paz.
We arrived here with the idea of making a restaurant that will take a little of Brazil, a little of Peru, a little of Chile, a little of Argentina. But we never thought that we were going to focus just in one country. Here and we start seeing 10,000 types of corn, another 10 types of potatoes, and suddenly you have 100 types of chilies. The Amazonic fish, for example. I mean, we start having this Amazonic fish that I have never seen in my life, very prehistoric fishes, and you say, okay, how many things we can do? I mean, this is great. And we just realized that we actually can make a restaurant who just focus in Bolivian products.
And Bolivia, especially La Paz, has never had a reputation for being a very big food city. There's a lot of really good culinary aspects, but as far as sophisticated and avant-garde restaurants, restaurants that are really trying to do something new, there is nothing like this in Bolivia.
Primero cuando sí entré, la verdad era, wow, así, todos de uniforme, con el mandil. Para mí era así fascinado, solo veía en películas. Yo antes una cocina la veía, o sea, quemándose y todo eso. Pero ahora para mí una cocina, después de gusto, una cocina es un laboratorio. Y pues no, en gusto para mí ahorita es mi segundo hogar, porque la mayor parte del tiempo estoy ahí. Y es mi familia, mi segunda familia.
It's a very sensitive subject, you know, and there's a lot of feelings involved, especially when you see where they come from. Some of them don't have families. Some of them have done a lot to be here.
This is way bigger than just a restaurant, just for money, you know, just to make food.
You can feel in the eyes, in the energy, that they are doing something important for them, for the country, for their families.
To be able to say that we have amazing cooks that are just spread all over the country, just all over the world, really. That would be revolutionary, I think, for a country like Bolivia that previous to this had no fine dining reputation worldwide. This is a grain of sand. It's the beginning of everything, really.
So, it is a very special moment for me to be here with you today. I remember when I first thought about this idea of doing something meaningful in Bolivia, I didn't know at all if it was possible to make it. To see you sitting here, graduating, and to come here as a guest in this wonderful building with all this life, it is, by any standard, the most important thing I've ever been part of in my life.
Good afternoon. I am grateful for having been given the opportunity to come here to your beautiful island and share with you the story of my life, the 15-minute version of my life, and how that eventually brought me to La Paz in Bolivia. I'm less grateful for having won the chance to just come on stage after the merengue, where we all feel like drinking rum and go dancing. So I make sure to make this as short as I can so we get out to the cocktail session afterwards. So I am from a very small country in Northern Europe called Denmark. And Denmark is a country where ascetic doctors and Puritan priests have led a 300-year-long anti-hedonistic crusade against the pleasure-giving qualities of food and against sensuality as such. For centuries in my country, the idea of preparing a wonderful meal for your family and friends has been considered a sin in line with theft, exaggerated dancing, abuse of alcohol, incest, or masturbation. The philosophy so successfully communicated by these fine people to my grand-grandparents was that if you want to live a long and healthy life on earth and avoid going to hell, what you have to do is to eat something of inferior taste and get it over with in a hurry. It was in this exact spirit that I was brought up in a middle-class family in the 60s, the darkest period of Danish food history. My mother, Ulla, represented the first generation of Danish women working outside the home. My parents raised me in the era of sauce coloring and of the stock cube on a diet composed of chopped fatty meat of the cheapest quality and frozen vegetables pre-boiled years before in Kazakhstan and Romania and Poland and then stocked in massive chest freezers in our basement. Most of the meat was wrapped 3 to 4 times in toasted breadcrumbs before it was deep fried in margarine packed with trans fatty acids. We used the excess margarine for dipping. No wonder that at the age of 14, I weighed 97 kilos and I was one of the 3 fattest kids in southern Denmark. As you may recall at this point, eating in my childhood was never a matter of reaching out for the beauty of life. It was a matter of economical efficiency. Food should be cheap and it should be prepared and eaten in less than 30 minutes. Then in 1977, when I was 14 years old, my parents decided to divorce, and that happened literally to the sound of the microwave oven. What then radically changed my life was 1 year spent as an au pair in Gascony, France, with a fourth generation baker, Guy Sversut, and his wife, Elisabeth. The meals and the time we spent preparing them together was the antithesis of life with my parents. Also, Guy and Elisabeth could not have children, and they had always wanted to have a son. So somehow, we were a pretty good match. There was a moment down there in Gascony, France, where the life philosophy of my father met the life philosophy of this Renaissance man, this Renaissance French family. My father believed that happiness was about doing everything you used to do, just faster and faster and faster. And one way he tried to teach me that lesson was by giving me the authority to cut the grass lane around our house. While I was doing that for 3 years in a row, while he still lived with my mother, he stood on the pathway giving me times for every round I made and penalty seconds if I left unfinished patches. Eventually, I became a master grass cutter. He was the opposite. He was a man who didn't care about money. He didn't care about time. He went to the local bar playing on horses, drinking Ricard and pastis, while he had 7 people in the bakery who had nothing else to do. He never challenged a price. He gave rebates to friends and family and neighbors. He created the most wonderful cakes, threw everything that wasn't sold out the next day without any sense of respect for money. His wife didn't appreciate it because they had no money to travel for or to buy a dress, or they were kind of poor. They just had the most wonderful food all over the place. So one day I decided to challenge Guy's ways. And I remember him returning from that bar. And I literally told him, you have to change your ways and your wife is unhappy. Then he told me two things I will remember till the end of my life. The first thing, he liked to quote poets. So he said, he looked at me with his warm brown eyes and he said, exactly what is written there. Le bonheur, c'est savoir ce que l'on veut et le vouloir passionnément. Et mon fils, quoi que tu fasses, il faut que tu l'aimes. Happiness, my son, is about knowing what you want to do with your life and having the guts to follow your heart. The second thing he said was also a reflection on the conception of time, because he then said, and remember these words, le temps c'est le pire ennemi non pas seulement des métiers de bouche, mais aussi de l'amour et de l'homme tout bref. Haste is the worst enemy, not only for gastronomy, but also for love and maybe for humanity as such. So with these words ringing in my ears, and with this 1 year spent in this culinary and emotional paradise, following 8-9 years spent in some sort of darkness, I came back to Denmark as a changed person. I wanted to be somebody who would change the food culture of my country, not to win Michelin stars or accolades, but to stand up for love, the concept of love and the concept of the family that I naively or romantically thought had a relationship with the quality of the meal and the food culture. So look at this. I went to Copenhagen Business School. I was the only student who decided to study the correspondence between microwave ovens in Danish families and divorces. I think it's a funny correlation. I did never win any major research prize, but I think it's worth a glance. The fact is that once I graduated, I opened my first restaurant when I was still studying, and then I ran around for the next 15 to 20 years trying to repair on all the food cultural imperfections I constantly stumbled across in the Danish culinary and commercial landscape without, in the big picture, in the big scheme of things, changing a lot. So in 2001, 15 years later, I figured out that it may be more efficient to try to take a top-down approach. Timing seemed right, because in 2001, the French cuisine had lost momentum, and the Spanish cuisine that had been more or less undisputedly celebrated for the previous 10 years had increasingly alienated itself from nature, leaning towards the concept of molecular gastronomy, where the chef alchemist, larger than God, uses artificial additives if needed to take food to some sort of next level. We decided to do two things. One was to open a restaurant that should explore ancient Nordic cooking techniques and invent new ones and work solely with local Danish and Scandinavian produce, which at that time was a totally outrageous idea. I onboarded a very young René Redzepi as a head chef and offered him a partnership. The second thing we did was to work on a manifesto trying to capture the big picture, because Noma was not about trying to build the best restaurant in the world. It was about building a restaurant that would showcase the potential of our culinary history, heritage, and more prominently, the potential of our nature. We wanted to change the system. We wanted to change the paradigm, and we figured out that we couldn't do that alone. We had to onboard the most important stakeholders in our agenda, and for that, we needed some sort of guiding light. I remember we wrote in the first menu at Noma that with this restaurant, we want to create a new Nordic cuisine that brightens the world by virtue of its great taste and its unique character. Pretty pretentious, you may think. And you're right. But the point is that food matters beyond pleasure. 90% being lost in less than a century, we are right now, once again, in the middle of a process of mass extinction of the biological species on Earth. This time, it is life destroying itself. Because in a period of less than 150 years, one very intelligent species is more or less single-handedly demolishing its own livelihood as well as large parts of the biosphere. 1 billion people are suffering from hunger and poverty, and it is very, very sad that another 1 billion people are suffering from obesity and diabetes. But then again, man holds a unique position amongst the living creatures on Earth. Evolution has provided us with the ability to think and show compassion. And as Leonard Cohen put it, there is a crack in everything, and that is where the light gets in. Luxury in 2003 was about foie gras, truffles, lobster and caviar, hand ironed tablecloths, fine dining for the few. René Recepi and I wanted to redefine luxury. We felt that humble ingredients and a naked table could be luxury as well. We wanted to emphasize seasonality and restore the link between cooking and nature, cooking and history. And we wanted to show that or document that deliciousness could be compatible with healthiness and sustainability, a position taken by no other food culture in the entire world. So a few months after the opening of NOMA, we decided to invite a very diverse group of key stakeholders to a Nordic cuisine symposium, asking the simple question, are we in Denmark, a food desert, allowed to dream of one day building together one of the greatest cuisines in the world, something that can be admired by people from all over the planet, something that we can hand over to our children with pride? And if we are allowed to dream that dream, what could then be the benefits for our country, for our region, as well as for the world? And then that is a manifesto, and it was signed by, funnily enough, a number of French chefs that were running the restaurant industry when we started, but now have a slightly more difficult time. The meaning of NOMA, as I said, was never to build or to be the best. And the purpose of the Nordic cuisine movement was not to build an introvert, elitarian brotherhood reserved for biodynamic farmers and wannabe Michelin stars. From the very beginning, we thought of this movement as a benign virus, an informal movement driven by not desire for short-term profits, but by the joy of building true value together. There was never a logo, never a precedent, never rules to obey, only a higher purpose and an appealing set of values that happened to be in harmony with the global zeitgeist. Our current food systems globally are unsustainable, unhealthy, extremely unjust, and very unequal. And the complexity of the problem is overwhelming, and sometimes you are left powerless. I decided in 2010, when my company started earning a little bit of money, to build a not-for-profit melting pot with the aim of exploring how what I had learned in my life, how that could benefit vulnerable and marginalized people in Denmark and beyond. To begin with, we got sidetracked and ended up opening food schools in Danish closed state prisons, one of the most rewarding things I have ever been part of. But the main idea was to see if it was possible to take out the word Nordic from the Nordic Cuisine Manifesto and use the same approach that we had been using in Scandinavia to deal with more serious problems in a very different country. And we ended up choosing Bolivia in Latin America, the poorest country of this continent, 26% suffering from hunger, a large unemployment rate, a country with, very interestingly, the largest biological diversity worldwide, and also a country longing for something to be proud of, because it's a country that has lost a tremendous amount of football matches and all wars in more than 150 years. So in 2012, in a collaboration with another NGO called IBIS and a Danish governmental investment fund, we started the restaurant called Gusto, it's fair to say that it has not been a walk in the park, led by the two people up in the left corner, Camila and Michelangelo, who is from Venezuela, Gusto has produced amazing results. We have graduated 52 students from the restaurant after they have been participating in a two-year-long apprenticeship model, and a number of these 52 students have now opened their own restaurants in Bolivia and work with local farmers. We have also been an enzyme or catalyst for the development of the Bolivian food movement MIGA and the annual street food festival Tambo. And then Gusto has established 13 small micro restaurants and micro food schools directly in the slums of El Alto. We've done that in a combination with a Dutch NGO called ECO. So somehow Dutch money found the idea and the educational model from Gusto, so that with the Manga food schools, we have, in the last 2 years, while spending no more than $500,000, we have been able to graduate 2,500 students from El Alto. Another 600 are graduating in November, 70% of which are women. And at the same time, we are offering from these 13 micro institutions a cheap $1 meal for the people who live in the slums that are obviously struck by poverty, malnutrition, obesity, and even violence. The idea of these schools is to teach the young kids from those communities nutrition and also the tools to develop a new occupation, and that to youngsters who otherwise wouldn't have a chance in life to get an education. So far, Manga have produced students who were now occupying 550 stable jobs in the Bolivian restaurant industry. 100 of the students have started their own initiatives supported by Manga. We are supporting 145 rural farmers, and we have, through Manga, developed 55 strategic alliances with companies and government organizations in Bolivia. And last but not least, Gusto, even though it's a social project, was voted number 14 on the list of the 50 best restaurants in Latin America in 2016. This year, yeah, that's good. The idea was never to stay around for 5 years, but we didn't want to run away before things were in order. And this has been the year where Camila and Michelangelo have been leaving. So now Mauricio Lopez and Marcia Taha are running the kitchen, and it's a 100% Bolivian team who is now running the restaurant. We fall down to number 28 on the same list, but I'm still extremely proud of the team. But now comes the very interesting years. So approaching the end, I think that the final thing to address is what can entrepreneurs and policymakers in the Dominican Republic and in the Caribbean as such learn from my experience. When I go to your supermarkets, I see that multinational food solutions are also invading your life, just as they are invading Bolivia, meaning that this will undermine your identity, threaten your history, and even threaten your health. When I look at your restaurant menus, I see a lot of Italian and French ripoff. I see too much fusion food, too many Caesar salads, too many panna cottas and balsamico reductions and too little original touch. So the most evident learning, I think, is that if you get food right in this island, in this region, if you manage to reimagine how your natural resources from land and sea can be turned into a lighter, vibrant, a much more compelling, inviting, engaging cuisine, a genuine, modern, truly Creole expression of the flavors of your region, something that can seduce young generations of Caribbeans, then this can have a huge impact on jobs, health costs, food export, and tourism, and also lead to growth opportunities in many other areas. Sec. Viva Dominican Republic! And merengue! The second learning, I believe, is that you can only get there if you manage to work together across the Caribbean islands and across stakeholders from various fields. This is not just about cooking, it's about fishing and farming, research and development, communication, branding, policy making, and entertainment. It is probably also about finding together an overarching common purpose that makes sense for all the stakeholders involved now, but also in the light of eternity. The modern Caribbean cuisine could be one of the most interesting cuisines in the entire world. You just have to believe in it, you have to talk about it, you have to work for it at all levels of society, and then you have to refine it and finally pass it on. A couple of years ago, I happened to listen to Steve Jobs' epic speech to the graduating students of Stanford. In that speech, he told that in his early life, he never had a plan. So now I speak to you as young entrepreneurs. And some of you are even mature entrepreneurs, or at least adult entrepreneurs. In that speech, he told that in his early life, he never had a plan. He then explained that he realized, and this is very important, he realized that you cannot connect the dots looking forward only by looking backwards. Therefore, you have to find something to believe in. Your guts, your intuition, whatever. Something that will give you the confidence to follow your heart, even when it leads you off the well-worn path. This will make all the difference. It is never too late to start searching. Remember, we will all be dead soon. And this is the best way to avoid the trap of thinking that we have something to lose. So this was a second learning. Trust your gut feeling. And point, well, like 2B is that it's also important that we don't all of us run around like idiots trying to be the next Steve Jobs, running a billion-dollar company. Because at the end, what counts more than anything is that we tried to be the best we could be. So let me say that in a slightly more poetic way by this final remark today. By sharing with you the legend of the hummingbird. And it goes like this. Legend has it that one day there was a tremendous forest fire. The terrified and shocked animals all looked at the disaster, unable to help in any way. Only the little hummingbird bustled about back and forth, fetching a few drops of water in its beak to throw them on the fire. After a while, the armadillo, super annoyed by this pathetic display, asked the hummingbird, "Tell me, hummingbird, do you think you're going to put out the forest fire by these small drops of water? The hummingbird answered, I know I can't, but I'm doing my part. Thank you.